you're a guest with us, we wanted to welcome you and let you know that we're glad to see you. In your announcements page, you will see that there is a QR code. If you will take just a moment and scan that QR code to let us know that you're here, we greatly appreciate that, and we can move forward with our announcements. So welcome, and let's get started this morning. We have our five-week book study coming up on Kate Ballard and Jessica Ritchie's Good Enough, and that will begin next week, so this upcoming week, June 7th from 6 to 7 p.m., and that's in room 117. So that study will continue on June 14th, 21st, and in and July 12th and 19th. So you'll need to contact Kristen. She's right over there. If you need childcare for that, and she'll make sure that you get set up for that. Our children's ministry summer hangout is on June 8th, and so that's the date after, and it's called Bikes, Skates, Scooters, and Popsicles, which, you know, that sounds like a lot of fun. So that's happening in the parking lot from 6 to 7 p.m., and that's for kids that are kindergarten through third grade. So invite your friends to come and hang out for that. Youth is happening this Wednesday, June 8th, and they're doing their Summer Olympics, so they're starting with some fun stuff this summer. So come off and come out and show off is the word there. All right, so and then we have our the next preschool play date happening on the playground on June 11th, and that's from from 10 a.m. to 11 p.m. or 11 a.m. That's a long time. 10 a.m. to 11 p.m., y'all. That is a long time. I apologize. No, it's 1 hour, so come and hang out. And then we have training coming up for URT, and that'll be held here at Salado UMC on Saturday, June 11th from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. That is actually a little bit of a longer day, but that eight-hour training is to become an early response team, a member of the Central Texas Conference. So if you're completing this training, you'll be issued a badge indicating that you have been approved to respond by the Central Texas Conference. And so, and that's up to 3 years is how long that you get that certification. So want to make sure that you put that on your date if you're interested in being part of the response team. Our baby bottle boomerang fundraiser is continuing on. So that'll end on June 19th, which is Father's Day. So we want to make sure that you are filling up those baby bottles and bringing them back. So we'll celebrate together once those are back up here. And yeah, lots of good things happening. The last thing I wanted to mention is that Vacation Bible School is happening on June 27th through the 30th. It's called a food truck party, which might sound strange, but it is so cool. The script is a lot of fun, and the kids are going to have a lot of fun and eat lots of cool food. And it's on a roll with God, which is a big pun. But it is so much fun. So we want to make sure that you get signed up for that, all the kids out there. And then also, we need snacks to be donated so that we can make sure that we get those kids something to eat during that morning. So anyway, that's all the announcements I have for you this morning. I know it's quite a lot, so thank you for listening to me ramble. But we're going to continue on with worship and just praising and singing. So let's stand together. We're going to start this morning with This Is Amazing Grace. Let's stand together as we worship. Who breaks the power of sin's darkness?
Who breaks the power of sin in darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves its breathless? All in wonder, the King of glory, the King of all things. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is a failing God. Yeah, you will take my place. Yeah, you will bear my cross. You lay down your life. for all that you've done for me.
Who brings our chaos?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of Glory, the King of our world. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I see for all that you've done for me.
He's not worthy as the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the devil who slain.
Say that out.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Oh, worthy is the devil who slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I seek for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me.
So today is Pentecost Sunday, and we've been talking about, in the first service, and you're going to hear from Dr. Mosser today, but a really long text, and he's going to tell you a funny story about that, but ultimately, when God sent his spirit down, I can't imagine what it was like to have been those people at that time, for the very first time, to feel the spirit of God. And Crystal's going to sing about that later in the service. But ultimately, God does incredible and amazing things. And we're going to continue singing about that. This is God is Able, so we're going to kick that off with this.
Overcome, for the Lord our God is able. is on our side, and He will live. Far above all we know, far above all we hope, He has done great things. Lift it up, He's the prayer. Praise to life, our God is able. In His name we overcome. For the Lord, our God is able.
Thanks, God. God is with us.
God is with us. He will go before. He will never leave us. He will never leave us. God is for us, and He has open arms. He will never fail us. He will never fail us. God is with us. He will go before. He will never leave us. He will never leave us.
Now one more time.
God is for us. He has opened arms. He will never fail us. He will never fail us. Lift it up. He defeated the grave. Raised to life. Our God is able. In His name we overcome. For the Lord our God is able.
Sing that to lift it up.
Lift it up. He defeated the grave. Praise to life. Our God is able. In His name we overcome. For the Lord our God is able. For the Lord our God is able. For the Lord our God is able.
Can we pray? Almighty God, we ask that as we come before You today, not only to discuss and to deliberate and to talk about the goodness of who You are and what You've done, but God, we ask that You open our minds, allow us to receive the gifts that You've given us, and allow us to receive the word that You want to breathe onto us. God, as we talk about how Your Spirit affects us today, let it become not only more knowledgeable, but more invested in our lives of feeling the Spirit and reacting to when You move us. God, we thank You. We ask that as we continue to praise You and to worship You, that we reflect on these words that we are about to sing. It's Your name that we pray.
Spirit was moved over the water. Spirit, come move us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moved over the water. Spirit, come move us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Spirit, when You fill the room, You're here and I know You are holy. I'm here and I know You will fill me. Spirit, when You come, when You come, when You fill the room, You're here and I know You are holy. I'm here and I know You will fill me.
As we come to our time of prayer this morning, we want to always remember those who you will find in the center of your bulletin, our church family, friends, and community members who are in need of our prayer. Ask that you would pray for them and be lifting them up at all times. So if you would please pray with me this morning. Holy God, for all of the ways that you speak to us, in rushing wind, in dancing flames, in words we understand, and in ways that transcend all language, we give thanks. So we pray this morning, Holy Spirit, come upon this place, pour out your fire of love upon us to be the body of Christ in a world that is often hurting, hungry, and cynical. Help us to bring the good news to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to captives, to bring recovery of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty all who need to be free. As your disciples, we pray for those who are suffering, who are poor, despairing, burdened, and battered this morning. In your loving embrace, we pray for health and wholeness for those who are physically ill, for those who are mentally ailing, for those who are spiritually unwell. We pray that the spirit of healing will come upon your creation and renew the face of our land. And we pray for those who are thirsty, that they would drink from the fountain of living water and never thirst again. We pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, how are you guys this morning? That good, huh? Well, that's about all I have for you today. Terry mentioned that story. This text reminded me of when I was at one of my very first churches. I had a lay leader there that wanted to read the scripture all the time. So finally, I just said, okay, this is your Sunday. So he got up and he read this text that we have before us today, Acts 2, 1 through 21, I believe. Yes, 21. When he got done, he turned away from the microphone. He was standing right in front of me, and he said, "Don't ever do that to me again." And I thought, man, maybe you should have done your homework before you got into all those non-pronounceable names that you're so upset about. But anyway, as Terry pointed out earlier, today is the day of Day when God set down the Holy Spirit upon a bunch of believers gathered in Jerusalem. The story comes from the book of Acts, and as you may know, and if you don't know, you could pretend like you know, that Acts is about proclaiming the Word of God in the mission of Jesus Christ, proclaiming the gospel, the good news, as we say. And this is a pure gift from God. And I would be willing to suggest that most of the best things that we have in life are gifts that we are given by God, by other people, and so forth. We receive and enjoy things like the affirmation and love of our parents or our neighbors or our teachers or our friends. That's what brings happiness in life, is people that care about us and will show us that kind of affirmation sometime. I had a friend that was the pastor of First Methodist in Findlay, Ohio, and I went up there to do a Bible study for his church, ironically on the book of Acts, and this was probably 25 years ago. I was excited to go up there because my brother lives in Dayton, so I got a chance to see him. As you may know, there are some churches where they make the pastor do everything. So He has to have the bulletins out and turns up. And, you know, Findlay, Ohio can get kind of cold sometimes, so you got to make sure that the heat's on and so forth. Anyway, I was sitting, leaned up against the wall at the back of the church while this pastor was doing all of his duties before the service started. And this older gentleman, he was an usher. He'd been an usher for as long as Queen Elizabeth has been sitting on her throne. He was in his early 90s. And I said, the pastor's name was Doug Mullins. And so I said to this older gentleman, because there wasn't anybody else around, I just said, "How do you like your pastor?" And he goes, "He is the best preacher that we have ever had in this church. And I've been coming here for 80 years every Sunday. I never miss worship." And I thought to myself, this guy's very dutiful, or he's a big fat liar. Anyway, he told me that. And I found it ironic because my friend Doug and I had spent a couple of days together, and all he did was talk about how discouraged he was in his church and how nobody appreciated him and so on and so forth. And I thought, you know, here's a guy saying that obviously spoke as if he knew something, said this guy was the greatest, and nobody'd ever mentioned that to him. So Doug and I had this conversation. So I said to this older gentleman, I said, "Well, have you ever told him that you thought he was a really good preacher and you were really glad he was there?" Because Doug was retiring at the end of the year. He'd just gotten so frustrated with his congregation, he was quitting. And the guy said, "Well, no, that I would never say anything like that to my pastor. I don't want him to think that, you know, that I'm so full of myself that I can make a judgment on his ministry." And I thought to myself, if these two would have connected and talked to each other, that church would have had a whole different ending to it than it did. But those are gifts that we can give to one another. One of the things that I say to most people that leave the church, you know, like Jim or Howard or somebody like that, I always tell them every Sunday, "You're my favorite." None of them believe it, but I always say that because it just seems like a pastoral thing to do. But those kinds of things we can't earn. We can't force people to say that to us. They're just pure gifts. They're pure gifts that we give to one another. And the Holy Spirit is one of those gifts. We know that God offers us salvation as a gift. It's probably the best gift that we can have. But God needs our cooperation in order for us to be saved. God does the lion's share of work in our salvation, no question about it. But God also hopes, expects, believes that we will somehow reach out to God to receive the gift that God gives us. Paul says this in his lesson in Philippians when he says, "Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling," and you work it out in partnership with God to one degree or another. Now, we know that God does most of it, but we must be receptive to the gift, or else a gift isn't a gift until you accept it. And I guess we all know that. So I would ask you, if you would, to hear the morning text, which comes from Acts 2. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. There's someone over there speaking in tongues. Is that Liam by any chance? Okay. Tell him that he can't come over and see his friend from last week because she's in Hawaii. Poor thing. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? How is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own language we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with the new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. Now, I told them at the first service that Peter had never been at the bus station in Dallas at 9 in the morning, because you could see plenty of people filled with new wine there if you wanted to. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. 'In the last days it will be,' God declares, 'that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.' This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Can y'all say that as if you had some small modicum of conviction? This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
That's a modicum. Okay. This text is so rich. It is so full of many, many insights for us that I've tried to boil it down to four pretty main points, and I'll go through these quickly for you. The first is, the early church, the early Christians, were obedient. Jesus told the disciples to stay in Jerusalem until God sent the gift of the Holy Spirit to them. And they did stay there. They were obedient, and we should be glad that they were. There's no telling what would have happened if they would all run away. Now remember, they've been there watching Jesus be arrested by the Romans, and the Romans question him, and then they send him to the religious authorities at the Sanhedrin. They question him, then they send him back to the Romans. It's like a ping pong match in a way, and and they finally crucified Jesus. So to say, stay in Jerusalem, that is a command that they followed, but they did it with religious conviction. They did it with obedient courage, because it would be pretty scary to stay in the same place and be associated so closely with Jesus that they could be also under indictment like Jesus was. And sometimes obedience takes some sort of funny twists. There was a fellow named Neil Martin, and he was a member of the British Parliament. And he took a bunch of American tourists on a guided tour of Parliament. During the visit, the group happened to meet Lord Howsham, who was Lord Chancellor. And I'm not sure what a Lord Chancellor is exactly, but he was dressed in the full regalia and all that kind of business. And as Neil Martin was taking these people and showing them various parts of the Parliament building, Howsham recognized him across the room, and he shouted out, "Neil!" And immediately all of the Americans dropped to their knees, thinking that he was commanding them to kneel. Now, of course, there's more to obedience than just responding quickly to a command. Like when somebody yells, "duck," sometimes you think maybe there's a ball heading for your head, or something, or a golf club, as it turns out this week, could be heading for your head. And these moments of obedience for the disciples were part of a genuine decision that they made. So the early church was into genuine decisions that they made, and it was certainly obedient courage. And what's hard for us is we do not like other people telling us what to do. We like to be completely autonomous people. We like to make our own decisions and go our own way. And when somebody tells us what to do, we don't like it. I remember driving down the road one time at one of the country churches that I had, and my ex yelled out to me, "Watch out for that pothole." And I don't know, something the devil overtook me or what it was exactly, but I hit that pothole with all four wheels. I know it sounds like it would be a hard thing to do, but I'm quite a talented driver in that way. So this decision that the disciples made was done out of obedience, and aren't we glad they did? The second thing that this text tells us about is fellowship, which comes from a Greek word called koinonia. It means to get together, or to be of one mind, or to have one purpose or impulse. There's a sort of intimacy that comes from fellowship, and the best churches have the best fellowship. John Wesley believed deeply in small groups. He had bands, he had classes within the Methodist societies, because he believed that we are better when we get together in small groups, and that we can share our faith with one another. We can tell of our troubles or have people celebrate with us in our victories. And as I look around the sanctuary this morning, I know that some of you meet on Monday night, some of you meet on Sunday morning. We have a Monday morning group of people that fellowship together. And fellowship is just one of the foundations that the church is built upon. And even though a lot of people think fellowship is just frivolous and just fun and games, Wesley wrote this: I want the whole Christ for my Savior, the whole Bible for my book, the whole church for my fellowship, and the whole world for my mission field. Which is to say that when Wesley puts fellowship with the Bible, with the mission field, all these other things that he thinks are important, it means a fellowship is really important. Third thing is that this text talks about calling on the name of the Lord, and this simply means that calling on the name of the Lord is a sort of a synonym or a cipher for praying. Praying's important. Now, most of us, I see prayer as a way to sort of nudge God to do what I want. God, heal my friend. God, heal my church member. God, send us rain. God, prevent war. God, fix our budget. Whatever it is, prayer is an integral part of who we are as Christians, and that's how we celebrate. It was an essential element of the early church. And then finally, I want to say that the early church planned. It's easy to say that one of Martin Luther's students of preaching said to him, I just get up in the pulpit and just let the Spirit speak to me so I can speak to the people. And so he had a particularly bad day one day. Luther said, what did the Spirit tell you this morning? And the Spirit said, you should have done your homework. Okay? There are ways that we as a church, in the midst of obedient waiting, in the midst of prayer, in the midst of fellowship, koinonia, that we plan the mission of the church to get the word of the gospel out into the world. That's what we do. Planning seems boring. How many of y'all know Tammy in our church office? Raise your hand. Tammy thinks that I don't plan enough. And I tell Tammy that I think she plans too much. So we don't really agree on this point very much. And I'm not going to ask the rest of the staff who's right, because they're as afraid of her as I am. But anyway, The idea of planning for the mission of the church is a really good idea, to be strategic about it. For goodness sakes, even in the sport of football, they have a committee meeting before every play to plan it. They call it the huddle. And it's a good thing to do, so everybody gets on the same page and is going in the right direction. Obedient waiting, enjoying the unifying fellowship of the Holy Spirit, prayer, and planning, that is what makes up the life of the church. And so now I would like to share with our congregation, the bread and the cup. On the night Jesus was betrayed, he took the loaf and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. After the meal, Jesus took the cup and he blessed it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, drink ye all of this. This is the blood of the New Testament poured out for you and many for the forgiveness of sin. As often as you drink of this cup, do so in remembrance of me. Let us pray. Gracious God, as we take these creatures of bread and wine into our lives, may they work for us the miracle of faith. And we pray this and all things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Now, there was some confusion when we did this the last time. I would invite everyone to come down the middle aisle and I will serve you the bread and then we will have the juice on either side. And that way people don't have to cut in front of each other. There was a reason for doing it this way, okay? Any questions? The time has come to come. Gracious God, thank you for giving us these creatures of bread and wine. May they strengthen us for the task ahead. And we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'd like to open the doors of the church. If there's someone that would like to join this congregation, make your pilgrimage of faith with it, or if you'd like to rededicate your life this morning on the day of Pentecost, come forward as we sing our final hymn, which is Holy Spirit. Duh, that's a great idea. Okay, please stand.
Let's stand together. Christmas family is the same.
may we receive the benediction. Go now in the peace and grace of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Y'all have a great week, and thank you for joining us today.
Welcome to our children's sermon for today. Today we are talking about one of my favorite church holidays, and that would be Pentecost. So, Pentecost was an important time that all Jewish people honored. They would come to Jerusalem and celebrate it. Pentecost was a festival. People came to Jerusalem from all over the world, and the disciples were also gathered there, because they were Jewish. This was to be the day that Jesus's promise that God would send the Holy Spirit happened. Suddenly, there was a big sound, like a rushing wind. Okay, I want you to think about that for a second. Think about a really loud wind. Then there were bits of fire that appeared. And this fire was special because it did not burn up or catch their hair or clothes on fire. This fire was special indeed, and it showed that God's Spirit was present. A lot of times in the Bible, God appears, or people describe it as fire. Can you think of some times when God appeared as fire to people? Well, one time that I can think of is Moses in the burning bush, and I'm sure you can think of some others as well. So, found in this fire was the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God, and it is the Spirit that makes all things possible. Sometimes we don't know what to say or how to pray, and the Holy Spirit comes in to help. The Holy Spirit came to these disciples and appeared as flames above their head. So picture this, but without the candle, right? Okay. The story is incredible, right? And it continues to get even more amazing. The disciples started speaking in other languages. There were people in Jerusalem who spoke a lot of languages, right? Because there were people from all over the Roman world in Jerusalem for Pentecost. The disciples didn't have their dictionaries or their translators with them, but they were able to talk to and understand all of those other languages that were spoken. So all of the disciples started sharing stories of Jesus. They were full of God's love, and they continued talking about the story of Jesus and sharing the amazing things that he had done. And a lot of the people that heard this came to believe, and they began meeting together regularly. They shared everything with other believers and continued meeting and sharing and caring for one another. And that sounds a lot like a church, doesn't it? So, at Pentecost, we get to celebrate the birthday of the church. Jesus had promised his followers that he would send the Holy Spirit, and on Pentecost, he did. The disciples were given the gifts of the Spirit. They began to preach in all of the languages that the Jewish people who were there spoke, and about 3,000 people decided to follow Jesus and were baptized that day and became a part of the church. And it was the start of an amazing way that God allows all of us to share the gifts of the Spirit with each other. God wants us to share God's story and his love with the whole world. That is an amazing story about God sending the Holy Spirit, isn't it? What's really amazing is that the Holy Spirit didn't come that one time and then go away. The Spirit still lives in the hearts of Christ's followers, and the Spirit is with us here today. The Holy Spirit guides us in the decisions that we make every moment of every day. He is our comforter, who calms our fears and fills us with hope. The Holy Spirit speaks to us through the scripture and helps us understand what we read. The Holy Spirit helps us. So let us listen to the Holy Spirit and what the Spirit leads us to do. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are thankful to you for sending the Holy Spirit to live within us and to be our comforter, teacher, and guide. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As you go out this week, every time you see a flame, remember, God is with you. The Holy Spirit is with you. Amen.
Hey, Salado Youth, Salado Youth families, hope that you're doing well wherever you are, whenever you watch this video. So people want lots of things in their life. We want to have the things that we need. And one of the things that's a very basic human trait, I think that we all want, is a little bit of power. We want control. We want the ability to influence the outcomes of our lives. We want to have the ability to weather the changes that come at us, because the world is a scary place. And so the temptation of power, of control, is one that's pretty common to almost every human being. We want that ability to control what we do. Now, maybe as a teenager, you feel like you don't have a whole lot of that. So you try to influence your parents to, you know, do the things that you want. But in the passage we're going to talk about today, we find some disciples who are in a very similar situation. In Acts 2, verses 1 through 20, we find the disciples after the resurrection of Jesus, just waiting on the gift that Jesus promised. And I don't know about you, but I don't like waiting. I'm not particularly the most patient person. I want things to kind of happen when I want them to happen. And the disciples were having to wait in this case. And when they did gather together and wait, the Holy Spirit showed up in an amazing way, a way that we call Pentecost today. The gift of the Holy Spirit came in a mighty way, in a sound of wind, in tongues of flame, in languages being spoken, in people's lives being forever changed by this event, including ours. This is the beginning of the change that has come to all of us believers. And a couple of things I want to note about this. First is that the disciples in this situation are not powerful in the world's eyes. Their leader's been killed. They're not yet proclaiming that he's been raised from the dead, and they're powerless. They have no influence. They have no money. They don't have any of the things that we normally associate with having power. But yet they have power from God that they are given. And that power is not for their own use. It's for the use of being witnesses. It's for sharing the gospel with the world. It's for sharing what Jesus has done in their life. It's for sharing just how much love God has for us. That's what the power is for. It's not for our own use. It's for God's use. And also want you to notice that this happened when they were gathered together, when they were in the same place together. And our gatherings as Christians are places where God can do amazing work if we show up expecting it to happen. If we show up distracted and worried about other things, we may miss out on the blessings that God's prepared to give us, on the power that God's prepared to give us, on the work that God's prepared to do to change our lives. So when we gather in worship and gather at youth, there's a reason we do those things beyond just having something to do. It's so that we can be together and we can learn from each other and we can see God's Spirit moving among us as a community. So I hope that as we go through the summer, that when there are opportunities for you to be here for worship or youth events, that you'll take advantage of that. And that even when we're having fun or singing songs or all the things that we do, that you will see God working in those events and that you will keep your heart open for what God has to say to you through those things. Just like the disciples did, they were waiting expectantly for that to happen, and God showed up and changed the world. So thank you for watching. Hope that you are having a wonderful summer. Know that you are loved. We will see you soon.